Hello, and welcome to the Osgoode Township Museum. My name is Larry Robinson, and I grew up on a farm, family farm, not far from here in Marvelville, Ontario. My love for hockey started, like so many kids, during the winter on freezing cold outdoor rinks, playing pickup games with friends while pretending to be our hockey heroes. I remember skating on some of the creeks and ponds, and that seemed to go on for miles. My career in the National Hockey League officially started in 1972 and lasted 17 seasons with the Montreal Canadiens. And then I played three more years in Los Angeles. They retired my number 19 jersey on November 19th, 2007 at a ceremony at the Bell Center in Montreal. I would like to extend my congratulations to the Osgoode Township Museum on opening of their brand new permanent exhibition, and I would like to welcome visitors into the museum. Rooted in Rural, Cultivating Connections celebrates all aspects of life in Osgoode Township, from its beginnings of contact with the first people to changing rural landscape to the people that helped shape and make the local community into what it is today. Listen, watch, learn, and explore the stories of the community in this new exhibition gallery space. We hope you enjoy your visit and invite you back again to visit the museum again soon.
So we're going to start going over the questions that I prepared for you today. Okay. And then I have something else at the end as well that we'll go over.
Sure. No problem.
All right. So starting at the beginning, your early childhood and life growing up in the area. Tell us about your childhood and growing up on a farm in Marvelville, Ontario. What are some of the memories that you have about life as a kid in the rural area?
Well, first of all, I grew up in Marvelville. My dad and my uncle were dairy farmers, and so we lived kind of close to each other. And so most of my childhood, when you were old enough to drive a tractor, you were working in the fields or milking cows or baling hay or doing something like that. And the only time that you really got any playtime was when all the chores and everything were done. So we played a lot of baseball, fastball. I grew up in a one-room school. So I went to public school where all the grades from grade one to grade eight, we're all in the same school. So there was no going graduated to a different. Mm-hmm. Yeah, everybody was together. So I remember that exclusively because my last year when I graduated from grade eight, our school closed down, and it is now the Marvelville Community Center. So I had the fortunate pleasure of when we won our first Stanley Cup to bring the Stanley Cup back to Marvelville, and that's where we had all the presentation and all the people from around the area came back to Marvelville. But the biggest thing was that my brothers and a couple of the neighbors, we used to use the school when the winter came along. There was a pipe that ran from the basement of the school out to the outdoor rink. And so four or five of us would get together and we'd start flooding the outdoor rink, and one would flood and two other ones would stomp down the wet snow so that we could get a base. And then once we got the base, then we'd go there at night when it got really, really cold, and two or three of us would stay in the school to stay warm, and the other one would be out flooding until he got cold. And then he would go in, and then the next person. So we worked in shifts, and we had this big, it was an Air Force suit that we used because it was waterproof and it was also kept you pretty warm. So we took turns getting undressed, and the next person would get dressed. And then usually by the morning, we'd have a beautiful sheet of ice then that everybody would learn to skate on.
Oh, that's a great memory. Thanks for sharing.
Yeah.
Okay, we'll go to the next question. Could you tell us a bit about your family history and the roots of your heritage?
I believe there's some there's definitely some Scottish in our, because my mother was a MacDonald, and the Robinson, I do believe, was there was some Dutch heritage in there somewhere. But no, as far as I know, my grandfather and his grandfather before them were farmers that that started in the area. And every time, and in fact, my grandfather lived with my Uncle Ray. And I used to go to my grandmother all the time, and she would help me with my schooling because she was a school teacher in her early days. So it was, that's kind of what I learned. I know that my uncles, like my grandfather's brothers, when my grandfather unfortunately passed away at, I think he was 93, 94, he had one brother that was sitting next to, there was three of us. There was my oldest brother, Brian, myself, and Mo. So there was three brothers, and my grandfather had three brothers. So I don't know what my brother, I think there's 2 years between no, 4 years between my oldest brother and myself. And then there's another 4 years between myself and my younger brother. And so my grandfather was laying in rest, and his brothers were there, 93, 96, 90, 98 or something like that. So there is a lot of longevity on my, in my father's side.
Excellent. Could you please describe one of your early childhood memories of skating and playing hockey games on a local outdoor pond or rink? What type of equipment did you have during those times for skates, sticks, gloves, puck, even a net?
Well, nets that we had were mostly made out of burlap that, and I think one of the local farmers had welded some pipes together to make the net. But as I was saying previously, that we used to stay up all night to make all the ice, and it was, I don't know if there was somebody standing there that had a walkie-talkie or a spyglass or something, because inevitably the first thing the next morning when the ice was all beautiful, all these kids would come from all over the place and bringing their skates and everything and skate on the ice that we worked on all night. But I literally did not get my first new pair of skates until I was, I think, 7 or 8 years old. Seeing as how my oldest brother got the skates first, then I would get all of his hand-me-downs. So there were times when I would have to put 2 and 3 pairs of socks into the skates just to make them fit me. But we spent not a lot of time on the main rink. We spent a lot of time because there was a creek that ran for miles in the back of our farm that actually basically went through our farm. So when it was cold enough and we figured it was frozen, we would grab our skates and go down to the creek, put the skates on, and then we'd just go skating for miles and miles. And inevitably, there would be parts where we got to know. We'd say, okay, we're going around this corner. Be careful. There's a spring up there. So we would get off onto the bank and then walk around the bank and then get back onto the ice again and then skate. And that's where we spent tons and tons of times. And there was also Carson McVeigh grew up, we were about the same age, and there was a small pond just near the base of where his farm was, and we used to go down there and clean it off and play a lot of pickup hockey down there as well.
Awesome, thanks for sharing.
But as far as like sticks and everything, mm-hmm. a lot of the times, I mean, if you got a stick, today the kids, they're taking slap shots and everything else. Back then we didn't want to take a slap shot because we were afraid we'd break our stick, and so a lot of our sticks were either nailed together to hold them together, or re-glued or re-taped, and you basically had to redo because the sticks were the sticks now are ridiculously expensive, but you didn't get that many new sticks or new gloves or pads or anything else. You just you had a pair of skates and no helmets and gloves. You usually just wore your regular gloves because it was so cold out there. You just used regular gloves.
And would you use like a regular puck too?
A lot of times, you know, we would use a ball, a colored ball, because if you had the puck and the puck went into the snow, a lot of times you'd lose the puck.
Right.
Because I know in the spring, it was when the ice started to melt, or the snow started to melt, or especially around the school rink, you'd see guys over there looking around to try to find some of the pucks that got shot over the boards that winter, and take those pucks and use them for after. But no, because we didn't have pads on, a lot of the times it was tennis balls or a rubber ball that was colored. But the problem with the rubber ball is after playing with it for a while, it would get frozen.
So it would hurt.
We used to come home and we'd have these big red welts all over our body, and our mother would go, "What the heck happened to you?" And it's, "I had to block a shot or whatever." So
no padding on. That fun. Kind of.
I'm sorry.
No padding on to.
No. No. You had a pair of jeans. That was it.
Oh wow.
Yeah. Oh,
thanks for sharing. That's great. Keep on going on here. Could you describe your junior hockey career playing days in the local area when you played for the Brockville Braves, Ottawa MAW Rangers of the Canadian Junior A Hockey League? And then what it was like for you to move out of Eastern Ontario area and into a more densely populated place in the GTA in Kitchener, and what it was like for you to play for the Rangers of the Ontario Hockey League?
Okay, well, I'll tell you how I learned to, one part I forgot to bring up was how I learned to skate. And there was a pond in the back of my Uncle Ray's. And when we were learning to skate, we were given some skates, and then you got it was a chair. It was a regular chair, but they cut the top off the chair. And so you would hold onto the chair and push the chair around on the ice. And then whenever you got comfortable, you would push the chair away, and then you'd gain your balance. And then that's how you learned how to skate and whatever. But I never played organized hockey until I was 8 or 9 years old. And we had a really, really good peewee and bantam coach named Bill Liniger, who unfortunately was killed in a car accident. But he probably gave me the first start in how to play organized hockey, and he was a great man, and he had a big influence on me. And then of course I had a relative, I think was a distant cousin, his name was Erwin Duncan. He was part of the Duncan twins that used to play back for the Inkerman Rockets in the day, and his son and I played together in Brockville and traveled around, and so he also had a big influence on me. But my coach in Brockville, Dan Dexter, I originally had tried out for the Ottawa 67s, and they said, "Ah, no, and you know, you didn't get here soon enough," and so on. He said, "You can play for our junior B team." And so I was supposed to go down to Cornwall to play in a game one night, and there was a big snowstorm. So we got there late. The game had already started, so they said, "Nah, well, it's too late now, you don't have to play." And I met a guy there, Barry Fraser, and he invited me to the Brockville Braves training camp for the Central Junior A team in Brockville. And so I showed up there, and I meet the next and goes, "Have you ever played defense?" And I said, "Well, I played a little bit in peewee." And the reason I did it, I played a little bit in peewee, is because we only had three defensemen. So I got to play probably 40 or 45 minutes a game. And, so he said, "Well, we got the same problem here in Brockville." He goes, "We only have three defensemen." So, he says, "Well, you want to play defense?" I said, "Sure." He goes, "Oh, well, I'll teach you." And so anyway, he put me back on defense, and that's where I got started as a defenseman, was for the Central Junior team. And I played a ton. I got to play a lot. I got to learn a lot. I got picked up by the Ottawa M&W Rangers when we got beat out of the playoffs, and we went down to PEI, to play in the playdowns for the, I don't know what it was called, the Turner Cup or something like that. And that was I think my first year or second year in Brockville. And then I got picked up again the following year by the Hull Volants, the same thing. So I got to be coached by the famous Lally Lalonde, who was just a nutcase. I'm telling you, he was crazy. He used to scream and yell. He'd walk off the bus, and the guys and all the Hull guys were used to that kind of stuff. But no, he was a pretty good guy. But there I got to play forward instead of defense. So got a little bit mixed up. But again, it was Barry Fraser who got me a tryout with the Kitchener Rangers for the OHL. And so I ended up traveling to Kitchener. And at that time, I was just newly married, and we had a little boy. And so when I went to Kitchener, I not only had played junior hockey and traveled and played in that circuit, but I also worked for Kitchener Beverages. So my day started at 7 a.m. to go to Kitchener Beverages, work until 4, get off work at 4, go to practice for 5, get home at 6:30. And some nights, especially when we traveled to Montreal and the like, you wouldn't get back until like 2 o'clock in the morning. And then you got to get up at 7 the next morning to go to work. So it was my first year. And when I played in Kitchener, it was tough, but there wasn't a lot of adaptation as far as, moving to a big city, because Kitchener is a big little city, and that people were very friendly. It was a nice, clean city, and we lived with a really nice lady. We lived in the top of her house, and so she was really nice. She used to come up and babysit our son when we had hockey games, so my wife could go and watch the games and all that kind of stuff. But then, from Kitchener, I got some good exposure, and the guy, actually, I had been seen a lot by a guy from Los Angeles Kings, one of their scouts. So when it came time to the draft, I thought for sure I was going to LA Kings. And lo and behold, it was Claude Ruel, who had been watching me all the time. And he says, no, there's a big lanky kid that plays in Kitchener. We want him. And so I was the 20th pick overall in the 1971 amateur draft, and I ended up going to the Montreal Canadiens training camp.
Awesome. And thanks for circling back on who taught you how to skate. Thanks for going over that as well. It's great.
No problem.
So how early did you get exposure to the National Capital Region and the city of Ottawa that was nearby?
Well, since we were, I don't know, old enough to be able to go to the fairs and all that kind of stuff, we got introduced to the, we used to go to the Ottawa Exhall every year, because that was part of it. We were all involved in 4-H, so we showed cattle, and we each had a young calf to show every year. And if we were fortunate enough to win it at Metcalf, then we would go on into Ottawa and show at the Ottawa X. But we look forward to going into there. But I wasn't really, I guess I got my real first taste of what the big city life was when I first got my driver's license, and I was Expo opened up in Montreal, and we figured we would go down and watch the Expo 67, and holy smokes, that's I thought it was the biggest city I had ever seen. Again, Ottawa, we lived so close, and a lot of my growing up and going to high school and everything, we played a lot of football and basketball and that against some of the Ottawa teams. So I guess Ottawa was a little more comfortable for me.
Right. Okay, great. So now we'll go into questions about more of your NHL career and coaching career. Could you share with us some of the moments that still stand out to you in your professional hockey career? So, for example, your first NHL game, your first NHL playoff goal in 1973, your first Stanley Cup championship as a player, your first cup as a coach, last cup captured with the St. Louis Blues, of course,
yeah,
and your induction to the Hockey Hall of Fame in 1995 and being named to the 100 greatest players in the NHL history in 2017 as part of the 100th year anniversary of the NHL celebrations. So many memories to unpack and such an amazing career to reflect on. Perhaps you could go over one or two highlight that really stick out to you, but certainly so much to discuss in that respect.
Yeah, well, I was very fortunate. When I got drafted by Montreal, that was our first year that the Halifax Voyageurs from the American Hockey League started. And so that was my first taste of professional hockey, was when I went to, I moved down to Halifax and we lived in Dartmouth. And again, I was very fortunate because Montreal made a trade and they got two veteran players in Doug Robinson and Noel Price. And as it turned out, Noel was my defense partner, but he was also my roommate. And he was a great teacher for me. I had and I have to say that Al McNeil was probably one of the reasons that I was able to excel in the NHL was through his teachings and his guidance. He was a great teacher for me and gave me a wake-up call, because the first meeting that I had with him, and he said, listen, Larry, he said, you're 6'3" or 6'4" and getting to be almost 200 pounds. He said, you got to learn to use your size. Cause I could always skate. I was a good skater from day one. I think those were because of my days, you know, skating on the rinks around Marvelville, because that's all we did was, we didn't play much hockey, but we did skate a lot. And but he said, you know, you're big, and in order for you to be able to do the things that you want to do, you're going to have to get a little more room to maneuver out there. So he says, you better get mean. So he says, if you can't do that, then, you know, we're going to have to send you somewhere else. Like, ooh, that was kind of a wake up call, because here I am, first year. You know, we just moved down to the East Coast. I've got a family that I've got to worry about. So next game out, I think I got in two fights and scored a goal and three assists or something like that. And he brought me in the next day and he says, see what I told you, that's what you got to do. And so I changed the way that I played. And then we went on that year and we won the Calder Cup, the championship. And so when the year was over, we came back to Ontario and I had to get a job right away because I still had to pay my last month's rent in Halifax. So I ended up working from 7 a.m. till 7 p.m. with the Department of Highways. A lot when we built the road from 417 from Montreal to Ottawa. That's one of the roads that I worked on. So then I went back the following year and, you know, we had won, like I said, we'd won the championship. And then I had a pretty good training camp. I played all 10 exhibition games. So I thought for sure, you know, I was going to make the team. And then I got the call that NOAA, they were sending me back down to Halifax. So, you know, I the biggest thing, and I tell the kids now, I said, you know, you're going to get setbacks. The thing that you have to do is you got to make the best of your worst moments. So anyway, I went back to Halifax and I said, I'm going to show them that I deserve to be here. So I had a great start of the season. I think I had 35 points. By January, I was sixth leading scorer in the league. And I got a call January the 8th. I remember it like yesterday. And Al calls me in. He goes, they called you up. They've got a few injuries. You're leaving tomorrow morning for Montreal. You're going to play the Minnesota North Stars. The only advice I'll give you is the first guy that you see when he comes down on you, he says, hit him as hard as you can and let him know that you're there. So I get on the ice my very first shift, and who's in the corner but poor little Bob Nevin. And so I laid Bob out, Nevin out, and he was down on the ice flailing away. I don't know if I separated his shoulder or whatever. And then there was a big scrum started, and that's how we started the game. And I stayed up with the club from then on. I played quite a bit for the next probably 13, 14 games. And then I played a little less because some of the guys that were hurt started to come back. But then I got a call in from the coach. It was Scotty Bowman. He goes, Larry, you're staying up. So find yourself a place. So I looked for a place, and my dad and my sister-in-law went down to Halifax and packed everything up and moved my wife and everybody back. And we lived in Lachine for the first 3 years. And then after we won our second cup, which was in 1972. So now I won the Calder Cup the first year. Second year I come up is 1972. We started against the Buffalo Sabres, and I wasn't dressed for the Buffalo Sabres. So we ended up beating Buffalo, and we were skated. I mean, we had this Floyd Curry, who was a Hall of Famer, was skating us on the ice, and he skated the crap out of us. But we were ready. So now comes Philadelphia Flyers. So we lose the first game against Philadelphia. And so Scotty comes in and says, Larry, you're playing the next game. So I get dressed for the next game. I play a few shifts and do my thing or whatever. And the game goes into overtime, and I get a shift out there. And so I get the puck, and I started up the ice with the puck, and I was going to pass it up to Frank Mihalovich. And Frank goes, no, keep going. So I kept going down. I just got in the blue line, over the blue line, and took a shot on Doug Favelle, top corner. So we end up winning the game. That was my first ever playoff goal and first ever overtime goal. And I remember getting interviewed after the game, and I was scared stiff because I'd never been in front of a camera before. But that was kind of the start of my career. And then we had a couple of years where we did okay, but then came the 76 to the 79 teams that we had that were just, I mean, 76 team, we only lost 8 games all year. The 79 team, I think we lost maybe 12, and then we lost 6. So in 3 years, we lost as many games as some teams lose now these days in the first 3 or 4 months. So I was pretty fortunate. I played on some pretty darn good teams. Then I got that went all the way through. I ended up winning 6 more Stanley Cups with Montreal. And then came the 1989 season, and my contract was up. And so I went in to see Serge, and who was my teammate. And he wanted to offer me a 1-year contract. And I said, well, what happens if I want to play more? He goes, well, that's all, because at that time I was 30, probably 36 or 37 years old. He says, that's all we want to offer you. So I said, well, do you mind? I'm going to look around. So I ended up flying out with a good friend of mine, Donnie Cape, and his wife and my wife. And we met Bruce McNall out in Los Angeles. He offered me 3 years, and if I decided not to play the third year, he was still going to pay me half of my salary. So I said, well, that's a pretty good deal, but Montreal still had to agree to it. So we called Serge back and asked, you know, would they match the offer? And they said, no, we can't do that. So that's how I ended up in Los Angeles. And it actually, you know, when I look back, yeah, I probably would have liked to start and finish my career in Montreal, but if I had have done that, would have I ended up starting my coaching career? because I started my coaching career in Los Angeles. So I knew LA, I knew their team and so on and so forth. So it was a good decision for me in the long run. So then I ended up, and I'll tell you, this is a good story. How my coaching career started was I retired in 1992. I had a really bad ankle sprain. The doctor says I probably should have broke my ankle or probably would have repaired better. But I would have liked to play in 92, but I just couldn't. My ankles were still swelling and I had no support, no strength in the ankle. So I worked for a year away from hockey with Bridgestone Firestone Tire Company as a national spokesman in Canada. And then I get a call from Lou Lamoriello and he's with New Jersey Devils. And he goes, Larry, would you be interested in being a coach? And I said, you know, Lou, I don't know. I never really thought about it. Well, he says, can I come down and meet you? So he said, sure. So we met in Montreal at the airport at the Hilton. So I walked into the room and shake hands with Lou and everything else. And he goes, I got somebody you got to meet. And I look around the corner and who's sitting there but Jacques Lemaire. I said, what the heck are you doing here? And Lou goes, I'd like you to meet the new head coach of the New Jersey Devils. I go, holy mackerel, because it hadn't been announced yet. Mm-hmm. So anyway, then that's where it all started. Jacques and Lou had met together and Jacques says he wanted to take me as his assistant coach. So I got my start there and lo and behold, we end up winning a Stanley Cup in New Jersey. And then I got an offer from Los Angeles to go out there as the head coach. And then I coached 4 years there. And then I got to go back to New Jersey to be an assistant again. And then I ended up winning two more back there with New Jersey. So it was a two pretty successful careers so far. But then I just, you know, I wanted, it was a lot, it's a lot of work and it's a lot of time away. So I got a call to go to San Jose. And again, it's a long haul, but it was an offer I couldn't refuse. And so I ended up going out there for 3 years as an assistant coach with McLennan and Jimmy Johnson was out there and Jay Woodcroft, and we had a great time and we really enjoyed our time out there because we were closer. My daughter and her husband and the twin boys were living out in California, so they would come down and visit us in San Jose. And we got to visit in Napa Valley and everything else. So it was a great career change for me. But then we all got let go. And I was kept on as a consultant. And I enjoyed that work as a consultant. So I carried it with me. I consulted with San Jose then for two more years. But I found that the traveling was way too much. And they gave me the opportunity to sign on with St. Louis. And so I made another good decision and ended up going with St. Louis. And then, as you say, the rest is history. We went on and became the first team in St. Louis history to win the Stanley Cup. And for me, that was tremendous. I mean, my first win as a head coach came at the hands of Robbie Fatorik being fired when I was in New Jersey. And that was tremendous. I mean, that was a lot of hard work and a lot of sleepless nights because unlike a player, when the game is over, you know, your day is over. So you can go to bed and, you know, have a beer and talk to the boys and laugh and everything else. But as a coach, when that game's over, you got to get yourself ready for the next game. Then you got to look at films. And today it's perfect. You got a video coordinator. You've got, you could go to 1/100th of a second of the first period and see what happened then. Back then we had VHF tapes. So you had the forward and backward and remember the counts and all this kind of stuff. So it would be a lot of nights that I would be up until like 2:30 in the morning preparing for the next game. So when we won that championship that year in Dallas against the Stars in overtime, that was just euphoric. I mean, I was stupid enough to go running across the ice. I could have fell and knocked myself out, but the joy and the happiness of seeing all those guys and winning another cup, that was fantastic. And so when I got back to St. Louis, the guys in St. Louis during that run, they were asking me a ton of questions because, you know, they go, oh, you're here, you know, you had 9 Stanley Cups, you know, can you tell us in it? So they quiz me a lot on what it takes and what they were supposed to do and so on and so forth. So I it was fun because I felt like I was being part of it. So it was a tremendous highlight for me.
Oh, that's great. Thank you so much for sharing all that. The story about how you got to become a coach too, that was really interesting.
Yeah, you know what, Patrick, I didn't know. It's hard to take because Robbie Fattori, it was in 95 during the lockout. So everybody, all the other coaches had kind of gone home, and myself and Jacques Caron, who was the goaltender coach, we said, well, let's go down because the American League was still going. So we said, let's go down because we knew Robbie Fattori, and he was the head coach for our farm team. So why don't we go down there? At least it'll give us something to do. So we took our wives down there, and we stayed in hotels and so on and so forth for probably over a month and a half. But Robbie gave me a chance. You know, he said, okay, you want to be a head coach, you know, you're running the practice. So I got firsthand of what to do and what to look for and all that kind of stuff. So now all of a sudden I get a call from Lou saying that he's firing Robbie, would I be coach? And I'm going, well, I'm not going to say no to Lou. But secondly, I'm having to take over from a good friend of mine in Robbie, who I love dearly. I think the world of him. So it was kind of a hard position for me to be in, but give me an offer or a challenge, I'll take the challenge. And so for me, it was a nice challenge.
Yeah. Excellent. Yeah. All right. So what was it like to have the honor of representing your country in international competition? Could you highlight what the atmosphere in the Canada Cup series was like and what those times were like as well?
Well, it's so different than I remember standing on the blue line, you know, for the Stanley Cups, you know, for the anthems and all that kind of stuff. But now all of a sudden, when you're wearing the Canada jersey and you're standing there for your national anthem, you can feel your legs shaking, more so because now you're what went on in 1972 when we played the Russians, it had brought a lot more, emphasis on these international competitions. So now to be picked and to play for your country, I think it's not only an honor, but it's a great boost to your career. And in my first Canada Cup, which was in 76, it came down to there was 2 defensemen left that were going to get picked, myself and I can't remember the guy's name, but he used to play for Chicago. But I think I was a better skater than him. So anyway, I got picked over him, and who was my partner but Bobby Orr. So, you're talking about one of the best defensemen that ever played. So Bobby and I were paired together. And again, we went on and people always talk about different Canada Cups, but that final game between us and Czechoslovakia where, Rogi Vachon, and I think Zarella was the other, the goalie on the Czech team. They put on, we put on a show. It was a, the game ended up, we won 2-1. I think Daryl Sittler scored with about a minute or 2 minutes left. It was probably one of the best games that one of the best games that I've been involved with. So that was my first introduction to those Canada Cup games. And it was nice too, because, we got to train up in Banff. We got to go to Parliament Hill and meet the Prime Minister. And I met Trudeau. And then I also met Ronald Reagan and all these different politicians and everything else. So there was a lot of good moments that came with it, and a lot of people that you wouldn't probably normally get to see. So not only was it a great honor, it was a lot of fun, because now, and not only that, now you're playing with guys, not just guys, the best of your league, and you're not playing against them. Now you're playing with them. So, you strike up, different emotions that come out. A guy that you used to hit into the boards, now you're standing up for him if somebody else hits him. So it was good. I enjoyed it. I got to play with the Gretz, and I got to play with Gordie Howe and Bobby Hall, who was my childhood hero. Now, actually Bobby was my roommate. Not that I got to see him very much, but he was my roommate for the 76 Canada Cup. And so I got to, in these Canada Cups, I got to play with some pretty darn good hockey people.
Awesome. Thanks for sharing all that. That's great. Could you share what your experiences were like witnessing the NHL game change over the years between when you were growing up as a fan, the era that you played in, and then transitioning to being a coach, and what it's like now, and what maybe even the future holds for the game?
Yeah. Well, when I first started, as I was saying, the coach told me I had to fight a lot. So my first introduction into a lot of these games was every night you had a bench clearing brawl, if not one, if there was maybe two. And the biggest transition over the years was with the introduction of better equipment and face masks and helmets and everything else. The fighting side of the game has been kind of pushed aside. So there's not as much fighting anymore. However, I think the one thing that's happened, because they've brought in face masks and helmets and everything else, is that the sticks have come up a lot more. So I think you'll see a lot more high sticking or guys being careless with their sticks and so on and so forth. And the other, to me, probably the biggest change has been the taking away of that the center red line. It's made the game now. Our game was tough, precision, because you had to be able to make short passes. You had to be able to make plays to get out of your zone, because you couldn't just throw the puck all the way up the ice. Whereas now, if you get in trouble, you can fire the thing around the wall, and the guy can be sitting up at the far blue line and pick it up and tip it in. And then all of a sudden, now everybody, it's like a, I don't know, it's like ants going to honey or whatever. And so everybody congregates to where the puck is. So I think it's lessened some of the skill level of the less skilled players, whereas a less skilled player now can contribute as long as he's able to skate a little bit. I think the game is a lot quicker now, but is it better? I don't know. I mean, I sit with some of our guys when they bring some of our old games on the TV, and I see players from today saying, "Wow." He said, "We watched your game last night, and you know what their first comment is? You guys would have had about six penalties before, the game was 5 minutes old, because now you're not allowed to put your stick on a guy to slow him down. before, I mean, you'd be skating to the net and you'd be getting hooked or they'd be holding your sweater or what have you. So it's a less physical game now, but it's a more violent game because of the fact that all these guys are big. They're all tremendously conditioned. The skates are better, the sticks are better, the equipment's better. So the game has gotten much quicker, but it's probably like if you're driving on a back street of a road in a car and you have an accident, and it's not that bad. But if you're on a main highway where you're going a tremendous amount of speeds and you have an accident, it's usually more serious. So you're getting the same thing in our sport, whereas the game is so fast now that when guys do get hit, there's probably more serious injuries now than there ever was, especially head injuries. But I still think that the game of hockey is probably the best spectator sport of any of the sports that we have today, because you've got 60 minutes of constant action. There's always something going on. There's speed, there's physicality, there's finesse. It checks all the boxes. So not because I played it, I still think it's with the one game where it's fun to watch on TV, but I don't think the television does it justice. And you don't know what it's like for to have the speed that these guys are traveling until you get close to the game or you're at the rink.
That's great. Thanks so much for the insight. That's awesome. So now we're going to talk about I'll ask you about your career following hockey and love for the game and maybe some other interests as well.
Sure.
So you're a self-proclaimed cheering for the underdog kind of hockey fan. How would you describe yourself as a hockey fan today?
I started my career in Montreal and I had a lot of success in Montreal. So deep down inside, I'm still a Habs fan, Montreal Canadiens fan. I want to see them do well. I'm also now a St. Louis Blues fan because I like, I've met some really nice people in St. Louis. It's a great hockey city. It's a great sports city. And so I've built a lot of tremendous friendships back in St. Louis. But overall, I'm more a general fan. I don't cheer for one team or another. I just want to see a good game. I want to see a good game. I want to see good plays. I like to see players have fun. I like to see, I don't like the cheap shot artists, the guys that pretend to be who somebody else that they're not really. For instance, a guy trying to play tough who I know isn't tough, but because of the rules today, he takes advantage of that. So I guess overall, I'm just a hockey fan.
I would say the same. I'm a hockey fan as well. who do you personally like to watch in today's current NHL for players?
There's a lot of people I like to watch. I like this Borzello, the one at the kid in Long Island.
Barzell.
Yeah. I really like to watch. That kid's got skill. Yeah. He's got a lot of skill. And the other the team that I really like to watch is the Carolina Hurricanes, because they've got a lot of good, young, skilled players there. Aho, for example, is really, really good. And this Russian kid that turns the puck over and throws it, I think it's Kuznetsov, or is it? No, that's not. Kerkalainen. Thank you. Thanks, Patrick.
Yeah.
I mean, those kids are just so skilled, but they truly, truly, truly play like their coach. That's how their coach was. Mm-hmm. A hard worker. Brindamore, I mean, you could say a lot about him, but they actually had to kick him out of the training room a lot of times because he just worked too hard. But so I really like to watch them, and I like to watch, I think New York Rangers are going to have a really good team eventually. They're young, they're fast, they've got some good skill.
They just drafted Lafreniere, so
absolutely. Ed Lafreniere, yeah. Nice little Canadian boy, French-Canadian boy. So I think they're people that are that we're going to watch. They're going to be very, very exciting. Who else do I like? Well, I mean, the kid in Edmonton. I mean, okay, how can you not?
Yeah.
I mean, McDavid is tremendous. I mean, what he can do on skates is unbelievable. I think he's really helped the league out in as far as bringing notoriety to the game right now, and so he's a pretty special kid.
Absolutely, just the speed he can get to is incredible.
I played Patrick. I played again. The 100th anniversary, so we're in LA, and so I played in celebrity game. So of course he's playing in the celebrity game, and who's on the ice the first time while I'm back on defense with the Pronger is McDavid. Holy Mac, he went by me so fast I felt like a turnstilist. When he hit the far blue line, I was already at the back near the net because there's no way I was going to catch him. Oh no, he's and a nice kid too, a really really nice kid.
Oh, thanks for sharing that, Larry. So we're go to November 19th, 2007, when the Montreal Canadiens gave you the honor of retiring your number 19 jersey at a ceremony in the Bell Center. Could you describe what the day was like for you and for your family?
I was a nervous wreck. I had practiced for weeks trying to prepare my speech that I had to give that night, because I wanted to do it in both English and French. So I had some friends of mine help me with the French part, because I knew how to speak French, but my French was so slang, you had to use the proper words and so on and so forth. So I remember that was my biggest worry. But the rest of the time, I mean, they kept you so busy. There was, you know, you were signing autographs and doing interviews and making sure that all your family got in there right. Because at that time, my daughter, the twins were only probably 2 or 3 years old, and they're all seeing snow for the first time. And then I had my oldest grandson who was going to be, he came on the ice with me. We had to do a run through for the TV as far as what we were going to do in the dressing room and then coming back out on the ice and so on and so forth. And then, I don't know. I was really nervous because I wanted to, you know, I'm a very emotional person anyway. And I told myself, well, I have to keep it together. And, because I remember what happened in 95, when I went into the Hall of Fame, I prepared myself, but I wasn't prepared for that day when all of a sudden they say, you know, they call you up and now you've got to go to the podium and start talking. And so I let my emotions get the best of me there, and I hardly made it through the speech. But this was a little different, and because of the fans there are, the Montreal Canadiens fans are just the best. I mean, are they demanding? Yes, they're demanding. Do they want perfection? Yes, they want perfection. But for me, that's the story of my life. That's what I demand on myself, and that's what I expect from myself. So that didn't change. And so the ovation that I got and the love that I got from the fans that night was second to none. It was something that you really can't describe until you first feel it, and then so everybody goes through and everybody does their speeches and then you do yours. And then, so you feel good. And then all of a sudden now you got to walk over and you see your number going up, and then your heart starts to pound. And then, I mean, your throat starts to get dry, and then you realize, you know what, this is going to be up there, not just for me, but for these kids that are in front of me and for generations from now on. So they're going to be able to see my name there for as long as the hockey is around. So, I mean, that's pretty special. And for a young kid that came from a small town that milked cows for a living, you know, it was pretty special for me. So I'm so happy that I was able to grow up in a great community in Marlboroville to learn what appreciation is. Then that's what it's all about.
Oh, great. Thank you for sharing all that and giving us some insight into your legacy too. It's really powerful. So could you, you talked a little bit about this earlier. Could you describe what it was like returning home a Stanley Cup champion and what that was like sharing that celebration with the community, with your loved ones and with your fans?
Oh, that day was great. I'd always had remembered, you know, well, of course, Marlboroville. I mean, the only time that we saw everybody in Marlboroville is when there was a picnic or something. So, but now all of a sudden, you know, word gets around and we came down from Montreal because I had a place in Montreal. So the cup came in to Montreal, and then I had a 2003 Corvette convertible, and my good friend, Donnie Cape, had the same thing. Mine was, I think, red and his was yellow. So here we are coming down 417 with the Stanley Cup in the back of the car, making our way to the Marlboroville Community Center. And I remember coming down Boundary Road, and we got about a mile and a half, so that you could almost see the community center, but all you could see was cars for miles on each side of the road. And the closer we got, we're going, holy, look at this. There had to have been, no word of a lie, I'd say close to 400 or 500 people at the Marlboroville Community Center. So that was kind of the start of it. And I was, again, very, very fortunate. I had my grandpa's brother was there, and he was 104 at the time. And so we were able to get a nice picture of Uncle Willie and myself and my dad and my grandson, all five generations or whatever, for a picture of it. And it was terrific. And and of course I have a cousin who is a dentist, and he thought, because when I brought the cup back to Marlboroville, it was for in New Jersey. So he said, for a joke, he brought a Jersey cow, and he put something in the top of the Stanley Cup and had the cow eating out of the top of the Stanley Cup. So I wasn't too happy about that. But when I thought of it, the play on the word Jersey and then New Jersey, I thought it was pretty cool. But it was a wonderful day, because we went from Marlboroville, then we went up to Metcalf, and the same thing. We pulled into the arena in Metcalf, and the place was full. And of course, you know, it wasn't just me that won the cup. You know, it was a team that won the cup. But still, for a hometown boy to be able to bring something that these guys see on TV and to bring it back to your hometown and to share it with all these other people, it was a pretty special moment. Again, everybody gets to come down and take a picture with it and touch the cup and everything else. So it's a small thing that I can do on my part to make a lot of people happy. Then I'm very grateful for it.
Thank you. That's wonderful to share those memories. So besides living and breathing hockey, what are some of your interests, hobbies, or how you would like to spend your time?
I like to play golf. I was a boater. I boated for like 30 years. I've had all different kinds of boats and everything else, but now with this COVID thing going on, I haven't been able to get back home, and So I've had to sell the boat because we just can't get out in it. And also I've been involved in horses and playing polo for a number of years. In fact, before we did this video, I was over at the farm riding horses and doing some stuff at my farm. I enjoy that.
Awesome. That was going to be my next question. I understand you enjoy polo and horses. Could you describe that hobby? So you just did. So that's one.
Well, you know what, the polo, I'm like you. When I first heard the word polo, the only thing I could think of was the swimming, you know, with the water polo.
Water polo.
I'd never heard of polo on horseback. But polo on horseback, they call it hockey on horseback. Basically, it's same principles. Except that you don't have as many people involved. It's four aside. And because I play defense, I play back in polo as well. But my good friend and teammate, Steve Schutt, and I got involved when we were in Montreal. In fact, the girl the father and mother of the girl that works for me now were the ones that introduced me into polo. And she started working for me when she was 14 years old, looking after my horses and running the farm and everything else. And she is still with me this day, and she just turned 52. So wow. That's how many years she's been working with me. And she's like my other daughter. She's probably been with me more than my own daughter. But Steve and I had a really successful year. The one year I hired a guy from the Dominican Republic, who's become a really good friend of mine, Martinez, Eddie Martinez. And so there was myself, Gilbert Ayub, Eddie Martinez, and myself. And we had a polo team in Montreal, and we went and we won the President's Cup championship for our area, and we qualified to go to Kentucky for the Kentucky finals. And unfortunately I wasn't able to go because my training camp started, but we had a really successful year. I think we never lost a game all year, so it was good. You have a handicap from 1 to 10, and I got to be number two handicap, so I guess that's pretty good, because there's only probably 25% of the people that aren't professional that get to be a two or a three handicap. So nice. It turned out pretty good for me, and I love the horses too.
Awesome. Thanks for sharing. So are you a fan of the band Rush? And if so, did you ever meet them or see them perform live? My father and I are big Rush fans, and he mentioned that on Rush's 1980 Permanent Waves album, in the notes, they thank Larry Robinson and Steve Schutt. They say, thanks for the sticks. Do you recall this? And could you share the memory?
Yeah, it was a game in Atlanta, and Rush were playing. I don't know if they played the night before or the night after. And so we went... I think they were playing the night after, because Geddy Lee and those guys had a bus sitting outside the game. And so Shuddy and I got him tickets to the game. And then I ordered him, wasn't Geddy Lee, who was the lead guitarist?
Alex Lifeson.
Alex was the one that wanted hockey sticks. So I said, well, I'll tell you what, I'll trade you a dozen hockey sticks for a guitar. So I ended up giving him, actually I gave him two dozen hockey sticks, and ended up giving me a beautiful guitar, which I have to this day. I tried to play a little bit, but my hands are way too big, but my brother-in-law is a pretty good guitarist. So John Wilson, I gave it to John, and he still has it. But I think Steve went to school with Geddy Lee. They went to the same school in Toronto. And yes, I do like Rush. They're a really good band. They're a great group of guys. We sat and had drinks with a few beers with them for for a little while after the game and got to meet them. And every time they come into Montreal or whatever, we would go out for dinner and hang out with them. But it wasn't through my connection. It was more through Steve's connection, but that's how it happened.
Cool. Thank you so much for
sharing. Yeah, it was cool.
That's awesome. Yeah. All right. So now we're going to go, I'm going to share my screen and we're going to go into some museum specific related questions. So on the exhibit,
okay.
Some of the artifacts that we have in the collection, and I'm just going to turn my screen down. So could you speak to the artifacts that will be on display in the museum's permanent exhibition? And I'm going to share my screen and I'll show you.
Okay.
Are you able to see my screen?
Oh, Canada Cup 70. So that's the 76 Canada Cup stick.
That's right. Yeah. So that's one of the objects that will be going into the exhibit. Oops.
Nice. That's my first Canada Cup.
That's right. Yeah.
Look at the wood, eh?
Yeah. Your signature is on it too. It says "Best regards, Larry Robinson." You can't really see it, but it's there.
Yeah. That's the only thing that you have to do. We found out now is if you get a stick like for 76, look at how many years that is. And especially on wood, if you use a marker or whatever, the only way they'll stay for a long time, and this is through talking to these collectors and whatever, is you have to put varnish on them. Otherwise, they'll fade.
That's right. Yeah.
Yeah.
In the museum world, we use like an acryloid, like a B72, it's called, and you brush it over it as a varnish to like set that ink in.
Same principle to keep the air from it, right?
That's right. Yeah.
Yeah. That's cool.
Yeah. So here's your jersey.
Oh. Yep. That's from
All-Star Game in 76, right?
76. It was in Philadelphia.
That's right. And you were on the Western Conference All-Stars for that.
Yeah, we won. Yeah. We won again. Yeah. I think actually, I think Pete Mihalovic might have gotten the MVP at that All-Star game.
You have such a good memory. It's amazing. Like some of the stuff.
When it comes to, old Patrick, only when it comes to hockey. This morning I took off my watch and I've got a bracelet that says that I'm taking blood thinners. I took it off to wash my hands and I can't remember where I took them off and put them.
All right.
So I'm fooling you.
Don't fool me.
Yeah. Oh, that's the night, a puck from the night that I, sweater was retired. Yep.
Yeah. So that's going to be on it in the exhibit as well.
Oh, that's nice.
And then now we're going to go into some of the photographs.
Well, I have to look at those
that we have in the collection. So.
Who's there? Oh, geez. I don't even know.
Young Larry Robinson. How old do you think you are there?
I want to say I'd be like 12 or 14.
12 or 14.
Yeah.
All right. Let's see what we got next.
It has to be his red hair.
Here's a family shot of you guys, your family.
Yeah, that's the whole family. It's my mom, and then Linda is next to her, and then Carol. I don't know. Who would the little one be? Mo. Holy mackerel. Look at Mo. That's Mo beside my dad. And then Brian's in the back. And then I'm right behind my
right
sister.
Here, right? Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And next to him, that's my late brother, Brian, to the left side of me.
Right. Okay. And I got the back as well so that we could see.
Oh, there it is.
We could see the names and the dates with that. Thought you'd be interested to see that.
Oh, that's cool. That's really, is that when it was taken, 1957? At 6 years old.
Is that what it says? Yeah. Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
Wow. Mo was 7 months old. That's, oh my God.
That's in the museum's collection.
Okay. Well, if for Carol, it would be, okay. So 51, Carol would have been, Brian was what? 48, 50. Carol is 49, I think. July
1949.
Yeah, she's July 1949.
Okay. I'll make sure to add that to our records. Thank you. So here's another one.
Oh, that's mom and dad's wedding.
Yeah.
That's my Uncle Ray, right? And my Aunt Faye right behind him.
Right behind them in the glasses.
Yeah. And they lived right across the road from us.
Oh, wow. So you were probably really close with them growing up.
Yeah. Yeah. Awesome. Yeah. And they had two boys, Wayne and Jim. Oh, there's my grandma and grandpa.
Yeah.
Henry and Elizabeth.
So that would be, that's your dad's parents?
Well, my dad, yeah, dad and Uncle Ray, that's their parents.
Their parents.
And they lived in, Uncle Ray had the, like the main house, and then there was a, like a smaller house attached to it. And that's where grandpa and grandma used to live. And grandma, I used to go with her all the time to, and she helped me in school. She was great. She was awesome. When she passed, that my grades went down big time.
So these are, here's another one.
Yeah, that's the junior B team, yeah.
Yeah. That's a plaque that we have in the collection.
Yeah, yeah.
Your brother was on this team.
Right? Yeah, Brian.
Yeah.
In fact, I got a, see that one way up top there on the left? Andy Lavery right beside me.
Yeah.
He just texted me the other day. He's, where the heck is he? Oh, he's working. Oh, I forget where he's working. But anyway, he said the next time I come into Canada that he wants to get together. Then there, Brian beside him is Wayne Reed. And Wayne and I used to train together in track and field. Gay Ford, I think he's still living. Doug Hay, married my late brother's wife. And then they've divorced since, though.
And your dad, right, was the manager?
He was the manager, yeah. And this Irwin Duncan, that's the guy that I was saying was a member of the, what are they called? Inkerman Rockets. That was a very famous team way back for Canada. They played, they won a lot of championships.
Right. And when you mentioned that, I was happy because I knew we were going to go over this photo. So,
oh, great. See what and that's his son right there, Alan.
Oh, okay.
Alan and I, yeah, we played. In fact, when I used to go into Carolina, Alan married a girl from there. And so he used to come down. We'd meet every time, every day. Wow.
Here's
that's my first year of Voyageurs right there.
Yeah. And it, of course, signed by you. Nice. Very nice. Yep. Also in the museum collection, this is a photographic print that we have of this.
Okay.
And then here's
73, 74. Yeah.
Yeah.
Louisville Slugger.
So here's the. The
I have a
pamphlet that was given out when the day of the jersey retirement.
Yeah.
We have that as well, which we also used to promote the exhibit, and we got a lot of responses on it. We shared it on our social media page, and people loved it. Okay. The front cover. Yeah, it was really great. Huh. And now we're going to go into some of the Robinson family photos that were shared with us for today.
Yeah, there's that. Remember I was telling you about the Corvette?
Yeah.
That's my Corvette there. And you can see the yellow one. Just see by the gown by the guy's hand.
Oh, okay. I didn't notice that before. It's
yeah, it's his was yellow and mine was red. And the dinghies was the garage. It was a Corvette repair business that my buddy and I shared together. That's him right there in the orange. Yeah.
Orange.
Yeah. Look at that. That's all the people. That's, I think that's just all family, isn't it?
All family, yeah. That's what I thought that was kind of indicative.
Yeah, there's Uncle Willie right down at the bottom. He's 104.
Wow.
Right there, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, when you mentioned him, I thought that we would have a photo to go over. So it was
yeah, like, that's all my family are, and on both sides. And because Uncle Ray's family is up there too.
Right.
Well, that's a cool picture.
I can send any of them that if you don't have copies. I.
Oh, trust me, Patrick. I know I've got them somewhere.
Somewhere. Yeah.
And if I don't, my sister and them do. Yeah. I remember that one. Do you know that my aunt, that's my Aunt Jean, she just had her 93rd? No, she just passed away last year. She was 100 and something.
Wow. Got a lot of family members that have lived to see 100. That's amazing.
Oh, I know. I don't know. I can't live that long. I can't afford it. Oh, look at that.
This isn't the four generations photo that you had mentioned, is it? No.
No, no, because that's my, the one, Jason is my brother's oldest son, yeah. And that's my brother, Brian. And I don't know if that's got to be, who is that? That's not my son, because my son would have been older than that. I think that was Brian's daughter.
It certainly stood out to me. It was a unique photo putting the little guy in the cup. I thought that was really cute.
Yeah. I put my first grandson in there.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
This same day, or was it a different
time? No, another time.
Another time. So this is outside of the Marvelville Community Center, is that right?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
And would it still be there today? Probably, right? It's got to be.
The home of Larry Robinson? No, that sign's not there. No,
that's not.
If you go in the community center, I think there's something up there.
Okay. Cool.
But now it's called Larry Robinson Road. There's Uncle Willie.
The road that the Marvelville Community Center on is called Larry Robinson.
No, it's the next concession over.
Oh, okay. Cool. I didn't know that.
Yeah.
All right. There's
Uncle Willie.
Uncle Willie. And yeah, I think that'd be it for the photos that I had prepared for today. And
okay.
I'll just do a concluding statement and then we can wrap up, Larry.
Okay. Now before I forget, Patrick, would you like if I have some memorabilia around to send it over to you to put in? You want more stuff?
I mean, if you're willing to donate to the museum,
sure,
absolutely, we'd be interested for sure.
Okay, all right,
we can connect.
I didn't know how much. Yeah, I didn't know how much room you had. So,
well, you're to put it into context. You're going in. The memorabilia from you is going into the local legends area of the exhibit. So it's going to be highlighted with Orville Prophet, who are also showing as local legends. So we can certainly discuss that and, you know, look at it, look to make a plan for that moving
forward. Okay. Well, I can talk to Annie too, and anything she wants, you know, she can get a hold of
it. Thank you very much. It's very courteous and nice of you to offer that to us. So we appreciate
it. I know Orville Prophet, if that's.
Oh yeah.
What, yeah.
Do you have a story maybe you could share about him or?
I know the name Orville Prophet because I remember Dad talking about him a lot. He was a
Your dad was a big fan. Yeah, well, we have the jersey that I had shown you that's going to the exhibit. We're using Orville Prophet's dress shirt, bow tie, and then a dress jacket as well that is going into the exhibit. So
that's cool.
Maybe someday, good. Larry, you could come by the museum and see it in person, maybe post
COVID. Yeah. Once you get rid of this stupid COVID thing.
Yeah.
Well, if it doesn't get any worse and this vaccine turns out, then we may try to get down next year. So keep our fingers crossed.
Yeah, for sure. We look forward to that. That is it for questions that we had for you. Thank you so much for your time and support of the Osgoode Township Museum. We are extremely grateful and appreciative of your efforts to complete this interview and donate to the museum's collection. Again, this interview will be integral in adding to the exposure and success of the new exhibit and the Osgoode Township Museum for future years to come. Thank you, Mr. Robinson. You're a class act and a hero in this area. Thank you once again for everything. And yeah, we're very grateful. So thank you so much for your time.
No, my pleasure, Patrick. It was very nice talking to you, and best of luck with this going forward. And like I said, if you anything you need, I'm only a phone call away or a Zoom away.
Zoom away. Thank you so much, Larry. It was a pleasure. Right. And I'm so happy with today. And I know my grandpa, he was a big Habs fan. He'd be very proud of me.
Oh, that's great. That's great. Good for you.
Thank you very much, Larry. It was a pleasure to speak with you.
Yeah. Thanks, Patrick.
Thank you.
Have a good day.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thanks.